Thank you, Jesus. I'm just going to read this because, I mean, somebody got touched by Jesus. Somebody got changed by Jesus when they wrote this song. Somebody understood the transformation out of darkness into light. Hallelujah. Shackled by a heavy burden, in desperate need of the Lord. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I'm no longer the same. Amen. That's the difference. No longer the same. From darkness to day. From misery to joy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He touched me. He touched me. He touched me. And what a wonderful joy. What a wonderful joy that floods my soul. Woo! Jesus. He came. He came that our joy might be full. He took us out of that sorrow and that sadness. And He brought us over into the kingdom of His dear Son. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Something happened and now I know He touched me. Oh, since I met the blessed Savior, since He touched and cleansed my soul, I will never cease to praise Him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. Oh, He touched me. Oh, He touched me. And isn't it amazing? I can look back. I can go back to 5 years old when I know, kneeling at the altar, and I can remember it as if it was a moment ago, and it's been a long time. 5 years old, kneeling at the altar, I remembered what I said. I remember who was at the church. I remembered the move of God that was going on in the place. I remembered people getting touched by Jesus. And I said, I want that. Like a little child, I heard people speaking in that beautiful heavenly language. And all of a sudden, it became real and so alive to me. And I remember saying, I want that. And just as a simple child asked, a child believes, and the Holy Ghost came up on the inside of me and began to flow out of me. And the Camerons were up on the stage and they were singing, David danced before the Lord, he danced with all his might. Roy Cameron wrote that song, beautiful song, in the Holy Ghost. And I remember that night he touched me. And then I remember time after time after time after time he touched me. And it went deeper, and this relationship went deeper, and this relationship went deeper. And it's become more glorious every day. It has not gotten stale. That was a long time ago, people, and it hasn't grown old. I need him. I'm desperate for him. Whew. But when I think about every time he's touched me, those times that it just went so deep. And you know when he touches you? You know when you first just gave it all to Jesus and you felt scrubbed clean on the inside. Hallelujah. Like a brand new person. That's what it's all about. It's a transformation. It's totally transformed. That's relationship. We come out of being bound by the demon powers of darkness, Satan being our master, over into that thing being completely broken, completely cut off, completely destroyed, the work of the devil destroyed. It does not come over into this brand new baby relationship with Jesus Christ. That we begin in that baby relationship with Jesus Christ, and we're so completely and totally dependent upon Him. For everything, every moment. And that joy flooding your soul. And it never ceases. It just increases. It increases. If it's not increasing, then something's wrong. If your relationship is not getting stronger, bigger, brighter, if you don't know Him more, then something happened that was wrong. And you want to repent and start your work. First work's over because you lost your first love. You want to stay absolutely, totally dependent and passionate before him, overwhelmed by his presence, desperate for him to touch you again, desperate for him to take you deeper all the time, all day long. Oh, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. 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 I just get joy when I think about what he's done for me. I get excited about when I think about what he's done for me, what he's done for me, what he's done for me. I want everybody to receive what he has done. Everybody in the world, how can we hold it in when it's so explosive to us? How can we let anything distract us from this glory, from this relationship, from his presence, from his goodness? Oh, Jesus. He is so amazing. He is so good. Oh, hallelujah. Nesete koroshana ilekermosuri shile namakutala resene. And it doesn't stay the same, it gets deeper. A baby doesn't come out of the womb talking like an educated adult. And the same thing with the Holy Spirit, it just increases and increases and increases and increases. Except there's no end to him, ever. There's no end. He's eternity. Father's eternity. There's no end. There's no past finding him out. For eternity, we're just going to go, whoa, Father, you're amazing. It is so good to serve righteousness, purity, and holiness, love, who our God is. He is love. And why anyone would choose anything but holiness and purity and righteousness is beyond me. It's beyond me. Why they would get allured over into a very meager, but for a moment, life that would lead them into such misery and pain. You know, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Poor in spirit, meaning that they realize they may have on the nicest clothes that you can put on. They may have spent $20,000 on their outfit and their shoes and, you know, their purse and their, you know, they drive a $200,000 car and they live in a mansion and they, you know, it looks like they have everything. But there's nothing if you don't have him on the inside. Amen. Poor in spirit. When you realize that you're poor in spirit, then you can reach out and take a hold of the kingdom of heaven. Because you know that you're in desperate need of him. That you must have him. That you're destitute without him. Oh, Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Oh. I think about that over in the Church of the Laodiceans. In Revelation chapter 3, they didn't realize look at this. The Lord says, I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I would that you were cold or hot. So because it's you're lukewarm, if you're not cold or you're not hot, you're lukewarm. He says, I will spew you out of my mouth. I will spew you out of my mouth. Look at this. Because you say, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. See, they're looking on the outside. See, so many people are still caught up on the outside. They're looking for what this life can give them to fulfill them. They're looking for their fulfillment in life. If I can just obtain this, and if I can just get this, and if I can just go there, and if I can just do that. And all along the way, they leave a train wreck behind them. They leave nothing but a huge pile of mess. But if I can just obtain to this, and then they get that, and they're just like, this feels empty. I have it, but empty. I must need this over here. I must have to have something else. There must be something else that I need to obtain to. You know, and God forbid the church be like this. God forbid the church be like this, but this was the church. The Laodiceans, it was the church. And God forbid anybody in the church be like this. If I can just get this job, or if I can just, you know, make this amount of money, and I can back off, and I can, you know, I can be able to give more, and I could be able to, you know, bring up my status, and I could, you know, whatever. And the poor, literally physically poor people in the natural can have a harder time at this than the richer people, even. But the rich people, they're always looking, and that's why when they get up to that place of obtaining all these things and it's completely empty, they kill themselves because there was nothing there. That's why they're married 3 or 4 times and they just, you know, they're just continuing on trying to find something that is going to satisfy when it's a spiritual condition. And we got a mouth with the answer.
Amen.
And people are looking for that.
Yes.
But look here. He says, you say that I'm rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. And you don't know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. And he said, I counsel of you to buy gold. This is the gold, the spiritual gold. See, the scripture over there in Matthew chapter 5 says, blessed are the poor in spirit. See, they don't know they're poor in spirit, but when you know you're poor in spirit and you confess you're poor in spirit, then yours is the kingdom of heaven, because you know that you're in need of a Savior. You know that it's only spiritual that is going to make the difference and make the change. And he says, I counsel you to buy gold, tried in the fire, that you may be rich, and white raiment. It doesn't matter about your outfit. White raiment. That's what you want to be clothed with, white raiment.
Amen.
His raiment. Amen. That's the clothing.
Amen.
That's it right there.
Yeah.
Woo, Jesus. That you may be clothed, and the shame of your nakedness, spiritual nakedness, does not appear, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. And look at this right here. Okay, I could just fall over in a heap right now and bawl my eyes out, because he's looking at this church right here. He's looking at this church that's just totally backslidden, totally away from him, totally lukewarm. And he says, as many as I love, I rebuke. The mercy of God. The goodness of God. He's dealing with his church that knew better. Totally backslidden. And he says, as many as I love, I rebuke and I chasten. And he says, be ye therefore zealous and repent. See, they had to repent. They were backslidden. Repent. You know, that's one of the first commandments that we find in the New Testament. It's the first one Jesus came preaching in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is coming to you. Jesus came out baptized in the Holy Ghost. There's 1,050 commandments, as far as I know, written in the New Testament. There could be more that I missed some, but 1,050 in the New Testament. We don't have 10 to keep. We have 1,050 to live in relationship with. To live out a relationship,
yes.
To allow that transforming and that renewing, to taking a hold of this new nature, and this is who I am. 1,050 relationship verses of who we are, what he's done for us, that we look and we're renewed and transformed,
yes.
In our minds. And we're looking, that's the old man, this is the new man, this is who I am, and I'm not going back there. Oh, hallelujah. Be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock, and if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in, and I will sup with him, and he with me, a backslidden church, and the love and the goodness and the mercy of God. That just does me in, the goodness of God.
Yes.
Because they knew better.
Amen.
And in his love, he came and he said, he brought the correction, but he said, come on, repent, because I love you.
Yes.
See, it's God's will that all men come to him,
yes.
Not some.
Amen.
People want to preach that it's, we were predestined and certain of us are going to heaven and certain of us are going to hell. But Jesus says, it's, Father says, it's my will that all men come to me.
Yeah.
That's his desire. That's why he's waiting for that precious fruit.
Yes.
He's waiting on that precious fruit to come in, for that all that harvest to come in. He's dealing, he's drawing, he's pulling, he's crying out. He's saying, come unto me. Oh, God, you're so good.
Yes.
But when you realize that you're poor in spirit, then you can mourn. Blessed are they that mourn, because you're going to take on salvation.
Amen.
You're going to be comforted. Father's going to come and he said, you're mourning over that sin. You hate it. You're done with it. You're letting go of it. I'm going to come in and I'm going to comfort you. I'm going to bring this transformation and I'm going to give it all to you.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
His good pleasure to give us the kingdom.
Amen.
The kingdom. Poor in spirit, we have the kingdom. Blessed are those that mourn because they're comforted.
Amen.
And he says, blessed are the meek. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And we can look over there in Psalms. You know, a lot of this is just written right in Psalms, different places in Psalms. We can look in Psalms where I think that's 37. Yeah, Psalms 37. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are they, are those that wait, you know, to lay it out, a gentle spirit, one that's patient, waiting, meek. It says in Psalms 37, verse 9, for evildoers shall be cut off, those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. And then you skip down to verse 11, but the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Those that are waiting on the Lord, those that are gentle, meek, and patient, waiting on God, not getting in a hurry to run ahead of him and getting a good, bright idea in God, but those that are waiting for God to move first and then you move with him.
Yeah.
Waiting to see what God's going to do and do it with him. They'll inherit the earth. They'll go in and they'll reap the harvest. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. See, he promised us the heathen for our inheritance, didn't he? Thank you, Jesus. Blessed are those that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Are you hungry? Are you thirsty? Are you desperate? How about like David wrote in Psalms? We could stop off. Let's see. In Psalms 42. Verse 1, as the hart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? Hungry, desperate, thirsty. For him to touch you. For more. Never satisfied with where you're at, but must be going deeper.
Yes.
Must know him more.
Yes.
Must behold him. Must see him. And then you can skip over to Psalm 63. Listen to this. O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you. In a dry and a thirsty land where there's no water, to see thy power and thy glory. So as I have seen you in the sanctuary, because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Listen to the desperation. This is us every day. We don't ever want to be in that place of Ephesus where we left the first love because we didn't stay hungry and thirsty and desperate to see him, to behold him, to know him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. And you know, Jesus is just as he's teaching out of the Psalms, you know, and a lot of people, you know, the word that is written, the written word, the word that come up out of David's belly as he began to worship the Father. And it was by the Spirit that he spoke these things, these prophetic things. He prophesied of the Messiah. He spoke the things of the Spirit. And this is in the Old Testament. And people, and you know, and here Jesus, he's confirming the Old Testament. Yes. And people want to say, well, is that New Testament doctrine? I think there's many scriptures where Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law, but I came to fulfill it. The righteousness of the law. Not the washing of the pots and the this and all of their little things like that. But the righteousness of the law, he came to fulfill in us by a transformed heart. By this relationship with him. It's just awesome how the Lord laid this out here. Thank you, Jesus. Hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And this one right here, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the compassionate. How many times Jesus showed us the example of compassion? He saw the multitude. They were unworthy, undeserving. They were sinners. They had gone back from even serving the righteous, any part of the law. And his mercy, he looked upon the multitude and he had compassion. Again and again, it says that in the scripture several times. Let's see, Matthew 9:36, 14:14. And I think 22, there's... Anyway, I'm not sure. But anyway, his mercy and his compassion. Blessed are those that have compassion. Blessed are those that have mercy. Oh, hallelujah. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful. My mother used to say, always have mercy in your mercy bank. Because you're going to need mercy. So if you're merciful and you're compassionate, what are you going to have?
Mercy.
You're going to obtain mercy. Father's going to show mercy on you. You notice how he says, if you forgive men their trespasses, so will your Father forgive those who trespass against him. And if you don't forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you your trespasses. And Jesus went far beyond that. He went beyond and had compassion on the multitude. I believe that he knew that many of them were going to be standing out going, crucify him. They were just there for the loaves and fishes, because he says it not too far away from here. You showed up for the loaves and fishes and what you can get. And he knew that before he went, and he healed all of them. All of them that came to him. He didn't go, no, you're not getting healed because you were bad. I know what you were doing last night. Believe me, he knew. He could look at him. He came to him and he had total revelation of everything that was going on. He's God. He could see deep down. But that's God. He causes his sun to shine on the just and the unjust. He causes it to rain on the good and the evil. He's God and he's good. And he's continually pouring out his goodness, and his will and his heart is for all men to come to him. Even those ones in the Laodicean church, even those that are backslidden, they had their chance. They knew better. And they grew cold and complacent and away from him. And they thought they were good and they had everything. And buddy, they had that scripture memorized and da-da-da-da-da-da. But their heart wasn't there. It doesn't matter what you know here in an organ, in a brain. Is it in your spirit? Is your spirit alive and living out his glory? Is this who you are in him? Is it relationship? Is he speaking to you continually? I love to just look at the word of God and just say, Father, what does that mean? You know, we could go and we could study this theologian. We can get out Pastor Mark's book on Ephesians, and we could get out Dake, and we could get out the concordance, and we could look up the Greek and the Hebrew, and, you know, we could do all of these things. And it's good, and we want to study, and we want to go back and look at all the scriptures and bring them all together. But, you know, just to say, Father, what are you saying there? And then he starts bringing scriptures to your remembrance, and he starts laying it all out, and he starts bringing it together, and he starts making explosive on the inside of you. And all of a sudden you read it, and it's like, bam! A bomb just went off on the inside of you, and you're like, God, you are so good. I mean, that's how I was, you know, I look at that church of the Laodiceans. I'm just like, oh, Jesus, you're so good. You're so merciful. There's hope for me. You know, because, you know, those times that you're just like, what am I doing? I'm running just so hard in the kingdom, but is that first love really kindled? Yeah. And you just have to stop and just get up close. Jesus. But just there's hope for people, and we don't ever want to look at them and just go, that one's not doing exactly so well. So, I mean, it's just almost like, you know, people shun people because that's religion. You know, that's a religious thing. You begin to shun the ones that aren't doing exactly instead of embracing and loving and caring and pulling them in and saying, you know, there's need there. I mean, that's Jesus. You know, so by the fruits you'll know them. Yes. Jesus is over there going, come over here. I mean, and you look at the way he loved on Peter. You look at the way he loved on Peter when he knew Peter was going to go deny him. But he's like, I've prayed for you, Peter. I've prayed for you. Have you prayed for somebody that you saw that isn't quite where they need to be? Or have you just run past them, trying to catch up with what everybody else is doing? Are you like Jesus? Will you stop and go? He's drawing you. What can I do to help bring you in? And you may not say that, but just love, the love and the compassion of Father. But I've prayed for you, Peter. And when you've been converted, when you've repented, because, I mean, Peter just totally messed up. He denied God 3 times. He said, then go preach. As soon as you've repented and you've been converted, you got this training, go preach to the other 11, not 10 that's left. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Our God is so good.
Amen.
Our God is so good.
Yes.
Blessed are those that are pure in heart. You see how this just progresses in chapter 5? Pure in heart. You have repented. You've received the transformed heart. You realize that you were poor. You realize that you were in need to repent. So you begin to mourn and cry out to God. And then from there, from the poor and the mourning and... just a minute, I'm going back over there. The poor, the mourn, the meek, and then hunger and thirst, desperate. And you come into that place, the mercy, the compassion, you come into that place of pure in heart, which God does when he transforms you right at the moment you're broken and you see your destitute need. But that pure man that walks with God in righteousness, you've taken a hold of who you are in God, and you live in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Whatsoever things are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, these are the things you think of. If there's any good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, these are the things you think on. Pure. Your motives are pure. Your thoughts are pure because you're hearing him. You're hearing what he's saying, and you're participating with him. Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The pure in heart shall see God.
Yes.
The pure in heart shall see God. There's no other way to see him. Mm-hmm. The pure in heart will see him.
Yes.
Only the pure in heart will see him. And then the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers.
Yes.
The peacemakers, the ones that always want to bring reconciliation and peace. Not those fighting and bickering and tearing things down. I'm telling you, people, and this goes on in the church, and I'm sorry, but it needs to be dealt with probably more than anything else. And if you can point it at other sins that you see that are so bad, but yet you would degrade and talk somebody down and destroy their character by your words or cause someone to think evil of them. Because when you say something degrading about another person, you are sowing seeds in whoever you're speaking it to for them to have an attitude towards that person. And that is sin. And yeah. God hates it.
Amen.
God despises that.
Yeah.
You just attack someone's character and you were a cannibal.
Yeah.
You were biting and devouring. What does that mean? Bite, devour. It's spiritual cannibalism.
Yeah.
You were just a cannibal. And you will be accountable for what you did.
Yes.
And those things meant you need to bring it to an end.
Yeah.
Bring it to an end.
Yeah.
Bring it to a place. If a person's not in the room, you're not going to sit and talk about them in any way. You're not going to try to help somebody through their issues, to help them come on over and by chewing on somebody and devouring them. You're going to be a peacemaker.
Yes.
You're always going to be there defending. Well, you know, I don't believe that that's exactly how the situation was. You need to be more understanding and loving. Or, you know, you're going to be the defender. And then you're just going to like, you know what? The person's not here, so let's not eat them.
Amen.
If they're present, then we'll, you know, I'll be glad to come together and talk to you and we'll get things worked out. But otherwise, our responsibility is to love them.
Amen.
Oh, that's a peacemaker.
Yes.
And those are the children of God.
Yes.
That's the children of God, peacemakers.
Yes.
Ones that are always looking to bring peace and bring unity and bring fellowship back, restoration,
yes.
Yes. Peacemakers.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
God's people should not allow it.
No.
I mean, we need to pause and press and get some major repentance going on about people that would just, you know, just make it a rule. You don't talk about people if they're not present.
Amen.
Unless it is you are saying something good. If you are attacking their character, just, you know, hush. If you're making light of somebody, when I was younger, way younger, I used to think it was so funny to imitate people and had the biggest blast at imitating people. And I would imitate Pastor Mark, and I've said this before, I'd imitate Pastor Mark. To Pastor Mark and have him laughing so hard he would cry. But I mean, so I wouldn't, it wasn't something I did behind his back, but you know, some people, you know. And I mean, you know, and Father just said to me one day, he goes, "That's my child." You know, and to comprehend and understand that if people see those things, there's so many people that they just can't take it, and it would be just so devastating to them. It would crush them.
Mm-hmm.
And to think that you could cause someone to fall away from the Lord because you were just being funny and having fun. And so, you know, I get these thoughts in my mind and I see these things, I rebuke them.
Yes.
I cast those things down. I try to be very careful not to allow that stuff. Because God loves every one of us. Every single one of us. He does not love me more than he loves you. I might love him more than some people do, but he doesn't love me more than he loves you. But he loves that fellowship. And he takes you deeper, and he takes you to a deeper place of knowing him and beholding him. as that fellowship and that hunger and that thirst and that passion and that brokenness and that desire for him. And you know, you're absolutely desperately needy for him all the time and just increases. It doesn't go away. You're absolutely always poor in spirit. Destitute and needy of him all the time. The increase there. And blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. For yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men will revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. So when you get to be persecuted, be happy about it. Don't be sad about it. When it's persecution for righteousness' sake, but if it's persecution for doing wrong, then know that Father's there knocking at the door. Jesus is there knocking at the door and saying, repent and I'll come in. I can't come in and have fellowship with you till you repent, but if you'll repent. But you know, the thing about the transformed heart, the thing about what God has done, the thing about understanding who we are, is there's not a desire to go back there. We have to step over that conviction of the Holy Spirit. We have to step over. And so many people in church sit there and go, well, they're so-and-so and so-and-so, and they're a pastor, and they're a prophet, and they're a, I don't care what they are. Right here. Right here, it's laid out. And when the Holy Spirit convicts you, you stop. And you don't look at what a man or a woman is doing. You look and say, Father, you transform my heart.
Amen.
And what does your word say? Because you said that you would come and you would lead us and guide us in all truth and you would teach us. And we look at the word and what the word says. Now we're to obey those that are over us in the Lord. And we want to understand that completely, because you know, the Lord told me many years ago with my dad. He was my dad and he was my pastor. Both. And there were some things going on, and he made judgment. And he has the right to make judgment as a father and as a pastor. And I looked at the judgment and at the situation, and I'm like, that isn't the judgment I would have made. You know, and I said this, he's my pastor, but I'm like, that's not the judgment I would have made. I'm just being open and honest with you. And I'm like, Father, I would have made that judgment, because I really feel like it's lopsided here, because I know the whole story. But he made that judgment. And I said, Father, I don't get it. I don't understand. I didn't go, well, I ain't listening to what he's got to say. I said, Father, I don't understand why he made that judgment. And the Lord told me, he said, he is your father, and so therefore he's right. He is your pastor, and so therefore he's right twice. So obey. I said, yes, sir. Because he will stand before God for his judgment, and he was in the place. And we don't want to step and try to mind things that are too high for us. We don't want to step into a place and try to mind things that are way too big for us. Well, we want to be careful about who we think we are and what office we hold. And I, as a woman, will never hold the office of a man. I can hold the office of a prophet, but I will never hold the office of an apostle. Never, because that's not a place for a woman. I could possibly even do the work of an apostle, but that doesn't mean that I'm an apostle. And I must always be subject to a man, because Eve, even though there is neither male or female in God, there still is subjection. And still divine order that is so clearly written out in Scripture. There's just divine order. Now I can step up and I can prophesy. And I can speak what comes up out of my belly. And it can be the exact word of God. And it's not my responsibility what's done with it. It's my responsibility to be in subjection. because God wants to train us in that. And that's a place of being just meek and lowly and humble and broken before Him and saying, it's not my gift, it's not mine, it doesn't belong to me. The Lord's anointed me. He's given me gifts, but they're not mine. They're His. Though they're mine and I possess them and He increases them and the gifts and callings of God are without repentance, they're still His. They're not mine. They still belong to Him. They still give to Him. They still came from Him. And I don't want to operate in them outside of Him. And if we step over into offices where we do not belong, we can find ourselves operating in a gift that God's given us, but by the wrong spirit. Lord Jesus, that's scary. So we want to stay in our place. We want to stay in our place and be obedient. Hallelujah. It's all good. It's all good because we're the salt of the earth. And if the salt's lost its savior, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is henceforth good for nothing to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. But realize we're the light of the world, a city set upon a hill that cannot be hid. A city set upon a hill. Neither do men take a light and put it under a bushel, but they set it up on the candlestick so everybody in the house can see it. We're right here in verse 15. So everybody that's in the house can see. There's light for everybody in the house. Thank you, Jesus. This is who we are in God. And we want to live in our position in this light as a city set upon a hill. Everybody in the church working in their function, in their place, in their position, as their part of the body. Because every one of us are a part of the body of Christ. We're His body that's supposed to be without spot or wrinkle. That's what He's called us to, and that's what He's coming for. He's not coming for a blemished church. He's coming for a church that's without spot or wrinkle. And a church that's functioning together. Not a church that's cutting off their nose because they decided it looked ugly and it wasn't a nice member and because this yucky stuff come out of it. So they decided that that member is not a good member because they don't like what comes out of the nose. Your body won't function too well if it doesn't work properly. But you know, people look at parts of the body and they judge by the seeing of the eye and not by the importance of that nose for you to breathe in that oxygen and exhale that carbon dioxide, for it to, it cleans and it filters. It has all kinds of important uses. And you know, I'm not trying to teach on anatomy, but I'm trying to cause people to see, you know, the nose and the body is important. We don't cut it off because we see something that we think is ugly, but we might do a little bit of helping there and encouraging. And people are kind of getting it. But I mean, really, we need these things to sink in. We are a body. We are His body. And we want to have that mercy and that compassion. Always, especially in the body. Because this is how all men will know that you're my disciples, because they look over there and they see this explosive love of God just oozing out of this body. It's love everywhere, from the hair to the bottom of the foot. Everybody is embraced and loved. And I don't know why I'm over here, but we are a body. And we don't want to say to the hand, I have no need of you. That hand is important. Jesus, we thank you. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father. We thank you, Lord. Lord Jesus, thank not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till it all be fulfilled. For whosoever shall break one of these least commandments shall be called the least in the kingdom of God. But whoever keeps these commandments and teaches men to do so, if you break one of them and you teach men to do so, you're going to be the least. If you keep the commandments, one. Look at your life. Look at the commandments. Look at the word of God. Are you allowing God to live in that transformed place? Are you being renewed in your spirit and saying, this is who I am in Christ Jesus, and this is what he's done for me, and I'm not allowing the enemy to come and try to sow any seed of discord, backbiting, dissension. I'm not allowing the enemy to sow hurt. Hurt won't be here because I am in Christ Jesus and he is in me. And so therefore, I will not be hurt, but I will receive what is needed. If there's correction needed, I'm going to receive that correction because somebody's watching for my soul. Or if a brother or a sister hurts or offends me, I'm going to look at the cross. I'm going to look at Jesus on the cross. And I'm going to take my example from him. I'm not going to take my example from somebody else. I'm going to take my example from the Word of God. I'm going to look at Jesus. And he hung on the cross. And he looked down at those that put him on that cross. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They weren't asking him to forgive them. He just said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do because he loved. He was on that cross because he loved us, every one of us. He went to the cross. He knew the purpose that he came into the world for was to go to that cross so he could make all things new in us, so he could make us new creations, so he could destroy the work of the devil, so he could take back what man lost in the garden. Amen. He could take back that complete relationship and fellowship and bring us up out of that bondage where the enemy had the grip. We are free from the powers of darkness. Satan has no place. He has no rule over us. Not at all. The only way the enemy can get place over us is if we give it to him. Our soul is secure in him as long as we stay in him and we allow him to stay in us. He knew what he was doing, and then he forgave. He came to make things new for the scribes and the Pharisees. For every one of them that would come to him. You know, and I was meditating on that the other day. I was meditating on that last week about how Jesus walked on this earth for 3 years showing the glory of heaven, showing the glory of God, and how they got angry about the glory of God, and they wanted to kill him. But you look when he came, riding in on that donkey and them going, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And the scribes and the Pharisees are like, we got to do something here. The whole world is going after him. Jesus couldn't be here long showing forth the glory of heaven, or he wouldn't have been able to go to the cross because men would have taken up and begin to fight for him in their own understanding, because he was captivating the masses. He was captivating them by the love and the goodness of God, because he came showing goodness and mercy. Amen. He brought correction to the religious, haughty, high-minded, rebellious ones that thought they were doing it all right, and they had the scripture down and they could quote it better than anybody else, and they knew what it is, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, they had it all lined up. You know, and like they said to the blind man, are you trying to teach us? You're trying to teach us? Because he said, it's amazing. It's amazing how you know so much. And then here comes a man and he opens my blind eyes, something that hasn't been done as far as we know since the beginning of the world. And you don't know who he is? And they got mad at him. But they were so angry at Jesus because he brought love and truth. And they wanted position and rank and respect and their pride and their ego fed for their position and who they were. And make sure you give plenty in the offering because we receive out of that. And we got to pick what new thing we're going to wear. Whatever, you know. I mean, just the whole mess. God came and he rebuked that. Jesus came and he rebuked that. But he poured out love everywhere. Nicodemus, when he came to him by night, he was just loving on Nicodemus. So many of them came to him. And I tell you, it would have exploded. Oh, Jesus. And he wouldn't have been able to make it to the cross. So Father had that perfect timing of coming and showing love like men never even comprehended could ever be shown. Because the scribes and the Pharisees were just like whipping people down, beating them down. Oh, you're not doing good enough. You know, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, like Jesus said, you won't do what you expect other people do. You won't even lift your little pinky to do it. And yet you're telling them and you're holding them back in their position instead of releasing them. And just made them mad at Jesus. Just like, I love you. Here, yeah, come. Be healed. Be set free. And he went to the wicked woman that was caught in adultery. And he just poured out love. And he says, neither do I condemn you. You're set free. Go and sin no more. I give you freedom. And that, I mean, oh, that one really made him mad. But that's God. And you know, when I tell you what, by their fruit you should know them. And when you're looking at somebody and they're wicked and you're shunning them because of their evil, when you have a bad attitude against those that bomb the towers and New York and all of the Muslim people coming in here and ISIS, and your heart's not going, oh, Jesus, they don't know you. They are only caught in this because they don't know you. Father, show us how to show forth your goodness and your love so they can come to you. But if you're on the side of crucify them or whatever, you know, against them and have any kind of attitude except the love and the compassion of God, watch out, religion. The same religion the scribes and the Pharisees had. Religion. Yes. Relationship is humble and broken and serving and loving and obedient. Even when you just are sure with the word of God, you're right. Isn't God amazing how he does things? He's amazing. He's just so good. He's good. And he just wants us to be just like him. And he enabled us to be just like him. And he says, this is who you are. Now you can live it because I've set you free. Now come walk in it. He says, come on, every day, be renewed in your mind. Be renewed, be transformed over here into my thinking, not your thinking, not man's thinking, not what the world is trying to tell you to do. Because if you love the world and the things of the world, they'll pull on you and they'll pull you down. And they'll get all over you again. And if you love the world, you don't have my love in you. You've turned around and you've gone after your own way. We want to make sure that we step back from the world and we don't allow it. You know, I was thinking about this today. You know, at one time in my life, there were things that I would watch on TV. Not a whole lot of TV. I never watched a whole lot, but there were things that I would watch. You know, and so I took example of those that were, you know, older than me and God, and you'd see other people watching these things. And, you know, I've never gone to the movie theaters very much. You know, maybe I probably could count on my hands how many times I've been to the movie theater and name the movies. I mean, and some people, they couldn't even begin to do that because they go on a regular basis to that stuff. But I didn't want to take that stuff in, you know, the fellowship. But I'd watch stuff on TV, and you know, I thought, well, you know, Grandma watches this, and Grandma presented herself as a holy woman of God, and she was very chaste in the things that she, in the way she acted, the way she dressed, the things she did. I mean, she had some issues that, you know, that she didn't have totally right, but I'm like, you know, Grandma watches Andy Griffin, so I can watch it. And I can remember as a child, I'm like, I was a little bit bugged by the fact that they lied. And I'm like, well, maybe you're supposed to just walk over top of that. You know, because, you know, Everybody else does these things. You know, as a kid, you go through this thing, and you're like, you're looking at the Christian world, and you're like, everybody else does these things. And then I remember, you know, my kids growing up, we didn't have a television very much in our home. Once in a while, you know, we kept this little teeny TV and put up in the closet, you know, and it had those little antennas. I never once in my life have had cable brought into my home. Never. My kids were never raised with that. We never had it. And I love to tell those guys that are trying to upsell, you know, get you to get more on their new cost. I've never had cable and I don't want it. And they're like, you never had cable? And I'm like, why would I want to bring that stuff into my home? Those things don't please the Father. I don't even want it on my TV. I mean, other people, you know, they can do that and they'll just turn to the news and stuff. And you know, if I had it, I probably would just turn to the news too. But I don't need it. I'm fine. I never had it, don't need it, don't want it, and I'm not condemning anybody that has it, if that's your relationship with God. But personally, you know, you can watch some of that secular news, and I feel stained. But, you know, I remember sitting down with my kids, and we watched something like that. You know, there was some bananas and that kind of stuff, and the people were lying, and I'm just like, stink, you know, this is in God. You know, and so I started setting standards. You know, if they're lying, if they're this, if they're drinking, you know, I don't care if it's John Wayne, which, you know, a lot of people think, well, good gracious, Pastor Geneva, John Wayne, you know, come on, don't mess with my John Wayne. Well, he drank. Do I believe in drinking? No. He's in bars. Do I believe in that? So I set that standard. I'm not going to sit down and participate with that. I'm not going to fellowship with that. I'm not going to have that fellowship.
Amen.
Because I'm holy and I'm righteous.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, you may be above that or around it or whatever. That might not be that's my relationship with God. That's how I see God.
Amen.
And so then I stepped over and I'm like, I ain't watching anything unless it's Christian. It's got to be Christian. And then I started watching a few Christian things and I'm like, I ain't watching that stuff either. We watch preachers.
Amen.
We watch Pastor Mark. You know, we listen to Tim Hall again. I already listened to Debbie Rich again. He touched me. Oh, Jesus touched me. And oh, what joy. Because I tell you what, there's nothing better than just getting raptured over in the realm of glory. And I don't know why I got off on that. But I got off on that. It's all about relationship. But see, if you break one of the least commandments and you teach men to do so, then you're least in the kingdom of God. Yeah. And if you teach men to do so, then you keep them and you teach men to do so, then you're the greatest. And our righteousness must succeed that of the scribes and the Pharisees.
Yeah.
It isn't, don't do this, do that. Because it's not about that. That's religion too. If you go, well, I don't do this and I don't do that and I don't, you know, and I'm better than you, and lift yourself up, and it's all a pride thing, and it's, you know, just trying to get points. That's not relationship, but it's relationship. The Father, He deals with you, and you're like, you know, and so many of the Christian church, they climb right over top of God dealing with them, of that conviction, and they find themselves doing stuff that they have no business doing because they're so used to doing it. And women's mouths can just go brrrr. Sometimes I envy men because they just talk about what needs to be said and they shut up. You know, really, one of the biggest things I liked about my husband was he was quiet. I came from a family that everybody talked at one time. And it was just always brrrr. And I got around David and it was just silence. And I'm like, oh, I really like this. Everything's quiet. Seriously, I did. And then he would say something, and it would be about the Lord, and it would be powerful, and it would go right down on the inside of me. And I'm like, wow, man. I like this. You know, because I never fit. I never fit. You know, when I was 10, 11, 12, my friends were 21, 22, 23. I was spending the night with the girls, that had just come out of ungodliness, and they were so excited about Jesus, and I was sitting there teaching them the Bible. We were doing Bible study, and I was teaching them the Word, and they were asking me questions, and I'm teaching them the Word. That was just me. I never connected with the nonsense kids were doing. And then I'd get around, I don't know why I'm in all of this, but maybe some of the kids need to just have it broken down for them. But I would get around all the preacher's kids. And Lord have mercy, those were the worst ones. They were our friends, but they were sneaking back behind Mom and Daddy's back, and Mom and Dad didn't have an idea of what was going on. And, you know, first trip in, after not seeing them a while, I go, and it was a mess. Next time, buddy, I ain't coming out of the presence of my daddy. Well, why don't you come and go to the movies? Well, I don't go to the movies. Well, why don't you come? You know, come, just come to the movies with us. It's going to be, you know, it's just a Disney movie. I don't go to the movies. I'm sitting right by daddy. I'm like, oh, this kid's getting involved and stuff. I don't want any part of that mess. I already saw what they do. I don't want their nonsense. And they're like, well, can we, you guys want to come in and watch TV? I don't watch TV. And at that time, I didn't. I would not. I was in one of those little vow times. I wouldn't turn the thing on. I wouldn't sit in front of it at all for nothing. You know, and here I am. I'm 14, 15 years old. And they're like, you are boring. I'm like, thank you. You want to go to church? And they didn't want to come to church. And I'm in church, and I'm getting touched by Jesus. Jesus is touching me. And I'm like, I don't get why they're over there in that misery. Because that stuff makes me miserable. Amen. I mean, the times as a family, and I know we're supposed to preach just the Word, but as a family, we would sit down and have TV sometimes in our home. We didn't always have a TV in our home, but we did when I was a kid. And stuff, they'd be watching stuff on TV, and I'd be so upset at that television. I would hide. I wouldn't watch it. And I'd pray. I'm like, Lord, cause that thing to blow up so we don't have a TV anymore. And I would pray. I'd be over there in the corner just praying, God, cause that thing to blow up so we don't have a TV anymore. And that thing would blow up. I prayed at least 3 TVs into blowing up as a kid. And I didn't do like Carlos Anacondia said when we went to his house one day. He said, you know, the kids were watching stuff that he didn't really like it. So he went and took some water and just poured it down the back of it. So the next time it went on, it came on, it went psh, psh. I didn't think of that as a kid. I just prayed. And buddy, I never told anybody in the family that I prayed that the TV would blow up. Because they'd all be mad at me. So I'm like, ooh, the TV blew up. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. But I'm serious, you know, and I stand before God for this. I did that. Because I didn't want that stuff. I didn't want it. I didn't want the torment. I was so, and you know, as a child, I was very sensitive to the things of the Spirit. I was very sensitive to the spiritual things. And I could go, we'd move into a house, and I'd start having dreams of things that went on in that house. And I was just sensitive. I don't understand all of that. But anyway, I was very sensitive with spiritual things. And I didn't want any of the bad stuff around me. Why? I don't get it. I don't get why people want evil. When we can have holiness and righteousness and fellowship with the Father, why would we want anything else? Why would we do anything that would breach that relationship and that fellowship? What is that worth? What is it worth to breach that relationship and fellowship for a moment of talking bad about someone? I tell you what, you must repent of that sin. You must repent of any attitude outside of the love of God. Because if we're in Him, we have His love.
Amen.
Jesus. And I'm not getting very far here. There's so much. Because you talk, just right here, what I quoted about the scribes and the Pharisees. For I say unto you that except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter the kingdom of heaven. You've heard that said of old, that, and then it just goes into commandments about you shall not kill. And Jesus says, look, I'm going to take it Further, if you're angry with your brother without a cause, you're in danger of judgment. And whosoever shall say to your brother, Reka, shall be in danger of counsel. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, say to a person, you're reprobate, you're destitute, there's no hope for God in you. You're in danger of hellfire. And we don't want to show those things with our attitude. And so, you know, and just talks about if you're going to bring your gift to the altar and you find that you have aught in your heart against your brother. And somebody, you know, somebody here might have aught or have some hurt or have something going on because I keep staying on this thing. But if you bring your gift to the altar and you have aught in your heart against your brother, first you go and be reconciled with your brother and then you come bring your offering. Because Jesus said sacrifices and offerings. He said, you did not desire, Father. But lo, it said of me, I come to do thy will. I come to do thy will, O God. Thy will to be the perfect sacrifice of us being able to live. That's Hebrews chapter 10. He came and sacrificed himself. He came to do the will of the Father and Amen. Sacrificed himself yes. so we could come and yes. we could live in the holiness and the righteousness of God. Not sacrifice and offering, but living our lives a living sacrifice.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Holy and acceptable yes. unto him. Which is your reasonable service. It's not what you can do for God. You can give yourself day and night to feed the poor and work in the church and this and that and the other. And if you've stepped outside of the relationship, it means nothing. Your offering only counts in relationship and coming out of relationship. Your giving only counts out of relationship. If it's not out of relationship and the pureness of relationship, it doesn't count. He doesn't desire it. He doesn't want it. He only wants an offering out of that relationship that he paid such a great price for you to have.
Yes.
Oh, thank you, Father. It goes on in this chapter and it says, if your eye offends you, pluck it out and cast it far from you. If your hand offends you, cut it off. For it's better for you to enter into the kingdom of heaven with a member missing than for your whole body to be cast in eternal hell.
Amen.
That's how serious God wants us to look at this relationship and what he's done. He has done the work. But if there's a member in your body that hasn't lined up with what he's done, get serious about it, whatever it takes. And so Pastor Mark says, smash the cell phone. Yeah. And I mean, Jesus said, cut your hand off or pluck your eye out. I talked about I didn't set the stuff of the television in front of my kids. You know, do something. I love how oral Billy Graham was. As something that just attracted me with Billy Graham, besides sitting in his services. I mean, I'm sensitive to the Holy Ghost. My dad preached at the water baptism, and, you know, he'd preach a message, and I had to get baptized almost every single time. Because because I was just sensitive. I'd go to Billy Graham, and Billy Graham could get everybody to the altar. And so I'd go to the altar knowing I'm saved, but just going, Jesus, I need you. But Billy Graham, He set up safety everywhere around him. He would never have these certain things. And one thing, he's going to a meeting, he would have his guys call the hotel room ahead of time and remove the TV. And one time, he tells about in one of his books that he called the hotel room and told them to move the TV, and they said, we can't remove the TV because it will mess up the wall, the way we have it hooked up, and then we'd have to repair it. And so we can't remove the TV. He goes, look, don't worry about it. Remove the TV. I'll pay the extra bill. I don't want the TV in the room. So he gets there and the TV's in the room. So he takes the TV and he rips it out of the wall and sets it in the hallway because he had made a covenant because he was going to keep himself separated, because he loved the anointing that God placed upon his life, and he wasn't going to allow the distraction, because the TV's there, you might just want to turn it on and see the news, but he wanted to pray and prepare himself for the meeting, that he was getting ready to go and stand before thousands of people. And he didn't want anything else on him but the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And the move of God.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
He wanted to be ready. And we just run headlong into everything. Que sera, sera. Look at anything around us instead of keeping ourselves and separating ourselves from the world and saying, I'm not being a part of it.
Amen.
I'm not looking at your mess.
Amen.
I'm not doing things. I won't go there. You know, there's just things that I just separated myself from. You know, I was telling somebody the other day, I used to like to watch baseball. My mom liked baseball. I liked baseball. I'd watch baseball. But one time I watched the World Series years ago, and one of the games were on Wednesday night. And I did not want to miss that game, because it was a good World Series. The Mets were playing. And when the Mets were here, me and Mom, we'd go see the Mets. And the Mets were playing and they were winning. And I didn't want to miss that. And then I missed church that night to watch the World Series. And I haven't watched another World Series since. The Lord convicted me so much, I didn't finish watching the World Series. I was done. I walked away from it. And I liked baseball. I've never really even cared about another game again because I want him. And not because other people don't have to do that, but I want him. I'm desperate. I'm hungry for him. And that's why I sit, you know, so much of the time on the edge of my seat, and I'm looking and I'm connected at whoever's ministering, because I'm looking about what Father is going to say to me, because I want him. And if Father says something, we should be so busy about doing that instead of climbing over the conviction of the Holy Spirit to go do what we think that we can do because somebody else did it and it was okay with them. And you know, and I told some other ministry this not too long ago. I said, look, I don't look at my brother and say, oh, my brother's up there preaching. I'm sitting there saying, yes, Father, because I'm not looking at a man. I'm looking at an office. I'm looking at an office. You can get familiar and be careless, but I'm looking at an office. And God's placed him in the office, and in the office of standing before the people, the Word of God is coming out.
Amen.
The Word of God is coming out, and I want to hear what Father's saying. And he speaks so directly to me so many times.
Yes.
And there's so many times that I'm just continually the rest of the week going, oh, God, I'm going to take a hold of this. Oh, God, I don't want anything in the way. Lord, I want to take a hold. Father, you were looking right at me, speaking right to me. We don't want to think too high of ourselves. And here's the deal. Just turn over. There's so much that we could talk about. Just turn over to chapter 7. I've been preaching in Matthew chapter 5, and if I never did say that, but I would think that most people would know where that is. And, of course, you had time to look it up if not. But Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. You know, we'll read verse 22. Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. And it's so important that you know the Word of God, because there's so much coming out today that is being said that people are gobbling up and they're taking because they don't know the Word of God. They haven't given themselves to the Word of God. They don't know what it says. And they're not under that fellowship and that relationship of a body and under a pastor. You know, they got church at their home, and they must have the office of an apostle or something. I haven't figured it out. If you figure it out, let me know. But they're not in a body, and they're not under authority, because they don't know the Word of God, and my people perish for a lack of knowledge. And not because the knowledge wasn't there and it wasn't given to them, but a knowledge that they would not receive or hear or apply themselves to. They wouldn't study to show themselves approved. A workman unto God, rightly dividing the word of truth. And if you can rightly divide it, you can wrongly divide it. And so they're gobbling up a whole bunch of stuff. And so you better know what the Word of God says, because there's going to be a whole lot of stuff that comes out in these last days, in the time that we're living in. There's going to be a whole lot of stuff that comes out that you could just swallow up. You want to be in a place of safety. You want to be somewhere where you know the man lives righteous and holy. And he won't step over top of God. He's going to be obedient. Because I can't find them. I walk into churches to go listen to other ministries, and there is just iniquity in the place. And if there is a church that doesn't believe in drinking alcohol today in this area, please let me know, because I would be interested to go see that church and to see that pastor and to shake his hand. They may not drink every day, but, you know, they're going to have their little bottle of wine here and there on their little special occasions. And they'll admit it. And I've seen where they admit it. And they don't see anything wrong with it, because Jesus turned the water into wine. You do err not knowing the Word of God. You tell me that they were drinking alcohol? Because, and I'll ask anybody this that starts in on that subject of wine, and I'm like, so you're telling me after, so just let me ask you a question. After you drink a glass of wine with your dinner, will you go make important decisions? Will you make financial decisions? No. Every single time they tell me no. No. I go, Why? Well, because. But they'll say that one beer doesn't get them drunk, or they'll say one glass of wine doesn't get them drunk. But isn't that amazing that they will not make any important decision after they've drank? They won't sign any important papers after they drink that one glass of wine. Quite amazing. You know why? Because they're drunk. They're intoxicated.
Right.
And you want to tell me that these people had drunk a bunch of wine, alcohol, and then Jesus goes and makes alcohol, and they're already drunk, and he just gets them slobbering drunk? You're out of your mind. You don't know the Word of God. You don't know it. And yet, pastors have gotten sucked right up into that. People that would have never done it before, because they were raised in the things of God and they were sensitive to the things of God. But you become careless when you step over the Holy Spirit, and you step over the Holy Spirit, and he deals with you, and you keep stepping over. And because God always makes a way of escape. You're tempted and you're tried, but there's always a way of escape. There is never one reason for you to step over the Holy Spirit. But see, you step over so many times, you're just going to run right over them, and you're in a total backslidden condition. You're backslidden. You need to repent, and you need to do your first works over. You need to start over. Christ needs to be formed in you again. You need to be transformed by the renewing of that repentance again. You need that. You resurrected the old man. And that's what brings people to that place, is just not heeding the conviction of the Holy Spirit, because they think they want to do these things so bad. You need to realize when that pressure of the enemy comes and tries to bring these things, and usually he'll start. One way he gets a lot of people is with discouragement.
Yeah.
Don't listen to discouragement. It's a lie.
Amen.
You're the head and not the tail. You're above and not beneath. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
You're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus.
Amen.
He came that your joy might be fulfilled in him. It is joy unspeakable and full
yes.
of glory to live over in this life.
Hallelujah.
There is no reason for discouragement. He is my dad.
Yes.
Man, I tell you, that feels so good to go, oh, Daddy, I love you. Oh, and I just want to please you, to fill that up close with him. To fill that up close with him. To where you realize those things are the outside, and the enemy is just, he just comes and he tries to forcefully demand and command you. But when you stand up and you say no, No, I've been transformed. I've been washed.
Amen.
Ah. Father, I love you and I love your righteousness and I love your holiness. And Father, I know that you are true and your word is true. And you said those that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And I don't want any part of that. I don't want any part of anything that's going to take me down to a devil's hell. And I think, and you begin to praise him and the enemy's on the run.
Yes.
You start worshiping God when a temptation comes. You jump up and you start worshiping God. You make that covenant with yourself that you jump up and you start worshiping God. And start with discouragement. Because discouragement drags people down to the place of the act of sin.
Yep. That's
good. So you get a little discouraged. We're not allowed to be depressed. That's a demon.
Amen.
That's a devil from hell.
Amen.
And discouragement leads into depression. And all discouragement is the devil lying. And why do you want to listen to a liar when you can listen to the Father of life and the truth?
Amen.
Jesus. So you start worshiping.
Yes.
And you say, Father, thank you for who you've made me in you. And I want to know you and I want to behold you and I want to see you. I don't want to see death. I want to see life. I don't want death. I want life. I don't want death. I want life. I want you, Father. I love righteousness. If you stop and you think about how much you love righteousness. Whoever wants to look at a drunken man in a gutter throwing up on himself and pooping his pants? Whoever wants to go, I want to be like that when I grow up. Can I be just like him? No, we look at royalty. Purity, holiness, and righteousness, and goodness, and kindness, and love. And we look at somebody that just loves everybody, and we're like, and they just have love pouring out of them, and we're like, I want to be like that. But that's what you're doing when you're choosing what the enemy does. I want to be like that man in the gutter with puke everywhere and poop in his pants. Literally, seriously, you are, because that's the end. The wages of sin is death. We have the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I don't know what time it is, but I'm just getting started. Remember I mentioned 1,050 commandments? We haven't started. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, we just thank you that your word goes deep on the inside of us, Father, and it brings change. Because, Father, we don't want to talk to a bunch of heads, but we want the Holy Spirit, Father, speaking to the heart. The heart. We thank you, Father, that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword. It goes deep down on the inside. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that it brings a change. Thank you, Jesus, that your word is spirit and life. But listen to this. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will. He that does the will. He that does the will of my Father.
Yes.
Jesus said, I can do nothing of myself. Mm-hmm. Jesus, he that does the will of the Father. He said in the garden, when Satan came to the garden to try to kill him before he got to the cross, when Satan come and brought all that torture in the garden, I don't know what all went on, but Jesus prayed and the sweat was as drops of blood. So there was a battle going on in that garden. He said, Father, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours. He was committed to the will of God, but he knew that he was set to go to the cross and that he would go to the cross. But the battle was big in the garden, and the angel came and comforted him. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
But he was willing to go through whatever it took to get to the cross, whatever battle it took, whatever it was, because his purpose, he came into this world to go to the cross. But it was never his will. And what is the will of God for us? What is God's will for you? What is God's will? What is God's will? Do you know what God's will is for you? What is his will? What does he will for you to do? What is his purpose? What is his plan? What is his will? What is his will? Are you living his will? What is his will? Are you living in his will? Only those that live in his will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only. What is his will? Are you living his will? Are you like Jesus with your eyes set to the cross to fulfill the will of God in your life? For this purpose, I came into the world, he said. What is his will for you? Do you know his will? Do you know his will for you? What is his will? Any interjection would be fine. What is his will? To keep his commandments. He said, if you love me, if you love me, if you love me, John chapter 14, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. This is his will. To be like Jesus. Those that say that they are his are to walk just like he walked in his purpose, walking out the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's look at that in the context of John chapter 14. Oh, hallelujah. You know, the two greatest commandments are in chapter 13 right before that. The two greatest commandments that he has, the two greatest commandments are right before that. Or, but you know, one of them is in verse 24. A new commandment I write unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. This is how you know that you love God. If you love me, if you love me, keep my commandments. The first commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with everything that's within you, with all your being, with everything. And the second one's likened unto it. Love your neighbor as yourself. But Jesus said, a new commandment I write unto you, that you love one another as I've loved you. That means you're not going to talk about somebody else because you're going to be willing to go to the cross and die for them. That's how Jesus loved.
Yes.
You're not going to hurt someone else. You're not going to shun someone else. You're not going to push someone else out. You're going to be all inclusive. You're not. You know what? And I'm going to say it. Say this. Because, you know, I keep trying not to go back over here. But people, you know, they have the attitude of, well, that person's just not quite, you know, we're not really compatible to be close friends. They're different than I am, and they're, you know, so, you know, I love them, but I don't hang out with them. Shut up.
Thank you.
You're just trying to twist the words around to salve your evil conscience. I'm sorry. We're to love everyone. Kissy, huggy love. Everyone. There isn't supposed to be anyone that doesn't fit in our group. And there's not supposed to be little groups that some people go hang out all the time, but, you know, you've got to do this to get in my group. By this shall you all men know that you are my disciples by the love you have one for another. That's just nonsense. And to say, you know, I really love that person, but I just don't like how, you know,
You know, that person, you know, they laugh really loud and they're boisterous and stuff like that, and it just kind of embarrasses me. I thought you were dead and buried. I thought you were raised up with Christ. You want to tell me Christ don't love them like he loves you? Give me a break. The Lord's talking to some people, I'm just telling you, because I know it, because I keep getting drawn back over to this. And it's getting spelled out, and it needs to stop, because this is the body of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we love everybody.
Amen.
And there isn't anybody that doesn't fit in the body.
Amen.
To hang out with. Thank you, Jesus. Because this is, you know, if you love like Jesus loved and you're willing to go to cross for somebody, my goodness, you're going to hang out with them if you have that opportunity. If you can bring them in. You're going to show them the love of God. You're going to be the example of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And don't wait on, you know, the pastoral staff to, you know, be the ones that you think should invite you. You be that one that goes and embraces and hugs and brings people along.
Amen.
And then maybe everybody else will catch up with you. And see right here, that love, that he loved us. And right here's the scripture. By this, and I've quoted it again and again, shall all men know that you are my disciples. Because that's who God is, he's love. And he came for me and he loved me. And he came to the church of Laodiceans, messed up, lukewarm. And he says, whom I love, I chasten. I love him. He's so good. He's so good. He's so good. He's so good. He is so wonderful. If you love me, keep my commandments. And then we just get started with 1,050 commandments. We look at them. Because if we love him and we keep his commandments, he comes and he lives on the inside of us. And he comes, he says, me and the Father will come and we'll set up our dwelling place on the inside of you. And this is how we know that we're in him. Because we keep his commandments and because we love one another. Thank you, Jesus. And seeing the Lord was saying, kissy, huggy, I'm going to have to hug a little bit more myself. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, because I want to be like him.
Yes.
And you want to be like him.
Yes.
And tonight you want to say no more.
No.
No more. No more discouragement. No more looking at myself and my ability and going off of that and then getting in my shell and all whimpering and whining about my situation and how I can't ever do anything right and I must always blah, blah, blah. It ain't about you. It's about him. And if you just say, Jesus, I want to be like you, he says, okay. Ask and you shall receive. Do you know that that is a commandment? Ask and you shall receive. Ask, seek, knock. You're commanded to ask, seek, and knock. It's not like, oh God, can I ask you for something? It's like, Father! Thank you that it's your pleasure to give us the kingdom. Lord, make your word real and living.
Yes.
Father, cause this to explode. Father, give me understanding and revelation by your spirit. Oh. And then it just comes flooding in and he's like, oh, his goodness and his love for us. He's never pushing us away. Never. He's always embracing us and holding us close. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
You know how to really live it out is by receiving that love and really knowing how much he loves us. And by really knowing how much he loves us, then we're able to love him more. Because comprehending and receiving the love that God has for us explodes love on the inside of us.
enables us to live out of all of the gospel, because then we would never do ill to our neighbor. We would never speak evil of them. We would never do evil to them. We would never want to hurt them, because we love them like we love ourselves and even more. Because the love of God explodes. So we embrace them. And I tell you, you know, a counter on the things that the enemy would do, if the enemy would put that, well, that person isn't quite, you know, we're not real compatible in to have a close relationship, go embrace that person.
Amen.
And go, I'm going to be compatible with that
yes.
person.
Amen. Yes.
Lord told me a long time ago, until you love the ugly, you'll never get the other. And you know what? When you embrace the ugly, you find out they're not ugly. That they're made in the image and the likeness
Amen.
Of God.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. This is good. This is good. God is good. And love is what all the law and the commandments hang on. Love. Because God is love. And we're to love Him. And we can't say that we love Him unless we love everybody. Because that is how we know that He is in us. And we could go through so many scriptures on love right there. And they're probably exploding on the inside of you. Be kindly affectionate one to another. Love, preferring one another before yourself. And on and on and on and on. That one's in Romans chapter 12. About verse 15, I think. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, what fellowship. Oh, what glory divine. Oh, thank you, Father. Everyone, just stand with me. If anybody wants prayer, I'll be glad to pray with you. And if everyone that has come into the house of the Lord, you want to come and you want to worship the Lord with what He's blessed you with, because I tell you what, you got up this morning.
Amen.
You were able to get up this morning, and you were able to take a deep breath. And therefore, it's the goodness of God that you were able to receive any blessing that you have. And we want to come worship Him with what He's blessed us with. And more than anything, with all of our heart, with all of our soul, we want to worship Him. Not with sacrifice and offering. And counting that is what He requires, but with a broken and contrite spirit. Loving Him. Loving Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So you can come and give, and if you want prayer, you can come and pray. And everybody can squeezy, hug, kissy, everyone too. But if we're praying for people, if people want prayer, please don't get into a conversation outside of ministry and worship in here while we're praying. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for the anointing. We thank you, Father, for the anointing. We thank you for the anointing, O God. We thank you for the anointing, O Lord. We thank you, Father God, that you are here to meet every person's need. Father, every person that's hungry and destitute, Father God, that wants more of you, Father, that wants to say, here I am, God. I want to live out my life totally, completely dedicated unto you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, I want to be touched deep inside, Father. I want more. Whatever it is, Father, I need a touch in my body. Father, I need a touch in my finances. Lord, I need more of you. Father, I just thank you that by your Spirit, you're here to meet every need. I thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for the anointing. We thank you for the anointing and the commitment on Aaron, Father. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. What do you want?
I'd say less important.
You don't feel good? Is that? Okay. Isaac. Isaac. We thank you, Jesus, for Isaac. We thank you, Jesus, that you've called Isaac. We thank you, Father, for healing in Isaac, physically, mentally, spiritually. Father, we thank you
Lord Jesus, that Isaac is yours. He belongs to you. In Jesus' name. And we thank you, Father, for the complete restoration and the complete healing in this body. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, every yoke broken. Father, peace that passes all understanding. Ruling this heart and mind. Everything, Father, that is not you, Father, is gone. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Isaac, receive. Receive, Ezekiel. Touch from heaven. Touch from heaven. Touch from heaven. Receive right now in Jesus' name. 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 Every perfect work, Father, you're working here. Every perfect work, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name. 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 Raise your hands. Raise your hands. The power of God is coming on. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for the fire. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Jesus, I thank you, God, that you have branded her heart, Father God. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you, Father, for the increase of your anointing. Father, the increase, Lord Jesus. You know what, Frankie, the Lord says get alone with him in a secret place more. Get alone with him. Hide away and don't let anything take you out of that secret place so he can show forth his glory. To you, through you, and in you, by you. In Jesus' name, that secret place, just you and him alone, that only you and him can go to. Only you and him. Yes, amen. You set that appointment with the Father. In Jesus' name, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm my beloved's and he is mine. His banner for me is love, 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 love. Love, 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 love. His banner over you is love. It's love, it's love, it's love. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, right now. Oh, you're Mukoma tianda rusu tole mishin kinji neni andeli ni ansoko ni shendi ni musoko papatela ni shoma ni ala na namate bokura vese ni se.